Right, so perfect. So why don't we get started here? It's 4 o'clock. So as always, we're excited to have you guys all here. I think today should be a good, interesting discussion. We're a little bit smaller group than normal, which I think is great. It's going to hopefully provide us a little bit more interaction. The three coaches that we have on today, obviously it's me, Matt Tendler, the goalie doctor. We also have Mitch Harris, the junior mentor. And then Mason Riley is another coach of ours that also works not only with us, but another tier one organization in the area, Virtua. But I think they're changing their name.
Flyers Elite.
The Flyers Elite.
Round 7.
He'll be getting some new swag this year. But obviously, I'm excited to have everybody here. I think it's going to be a good discussion. We're going to go over Mason's path. He's a local guy, played tier one in the area, then played juniors, and then went to college, had a pretty successful hockey career, got involved in the coaching, and then now his next endeavor is trying to climb the ladder and get to the NHL on a different path than a player and as a referee. And he's found a lot of success. He's got some games this year, USHL, the American Hockey League alike. So it'll be nice to kind of have his opinion on the difference of the leagues and also hear about his path of how he got there. So as always, we always have things going on, obviously outside of just the Zoom calls that we're hosting on Tuesdays. Mitch also is hosting one on Sundays. After this one, I think we got a hand-eye coordination set coming up. So hopefully everyone takes advantage of that. Mitch, is there anything else that I might be missing up on the...
Yeah, we have our virtual skate at 5:30. So once you're done with this, go grab a little snack and hop on back. Grab some tennis balls. You're going to need a concentration chart. Grab your glove and a couple of cones. And that's pretty much all you're going to need today. Tomorrow, I've got a live virtual skate. Goalie Rhino 32, who is in attendance now, will be leading that skate, doing the demo. That's at 5 o'clock. And if you don't have ice, grab your stick glove blocker and knee pads and a couple of pucks and do it on foot, do it on a slide board. We've had a number of different people doing them in different manners. So I would love to have you out. And then, yeah, we're back here on Sunday at 7:30 p.m. With special guest Jason Power, who is a goalie coach for the NA Kansas City Scouts and was just named the goalie coach for the Lincoln Stars, who happened to have drafted a previous guest of ours, Guy Blessing. And that's not a coincidence. So he will be on Sunday to talk about the difference of levels between the NA and the USHL. So other than that, that's all I've got. Mason, what do you got today?
Thanks for having me. First off, I've worked with a number of you guys this past season. You know, this is just to kind of go a little bit about my background and, you know, feel free to jump in with questions at any time in the chat or save them to the end, whatever you guys normally do. But like Maddie said, coach basically started coaching around here a few years ago once I moved back with my wife and our child. You know, New Jersey guy growing up from Washington Township, right down the street from Hollydale. Played Tier 2 there for a bit, then moved on to Team Comcast. Went to play junior in Canada for a short time, got hurt, came back. Bounced around a little bit around the injuries. Coach Tendler, the goalie doctor himself, helped me get back in the mix in the Atlantic Junior Hockey League with the Little Flyers, helped coach me there. Especially during the summer and in the season. And then actually he helped me commit my first time for NCAA Division III. And, you know, flip of a coin, you know, you move back, you get in the mix with the local Tier 1 teams. And, you know, a few of my buddies asked me to start reffing, jump in that mix. First time actually on player skates last year. Just right place, right time, doing a Division I hockey game. At Army West Point, and the NHL was there. So even after the fact of playing, you never know who's watching. And I got invited to the NHL officiating combine this summer and signed a deal to ref full-time in the American Hockey League.
That's pretty awesome, Mason. You never could do it as a goalie, so you had to do it as a ref, huh?
Sure, absolutely. Funny story. The guy actually did my first Division I game with. He was supposed to be working. That game a couple weeks later, and basically he tore his knee. It was just right place, right time. He couldn't do it. Our boss called me up, said, hey, can you get up to Army? I said, yeah. And you know, it was all uphill from there. Actually, the head of officiating for the NHL, Steve Walkham, his son played for Bentley. So he was actually at the game too. So you never know who's watching. You know, just skated. It was my first year lining and officiating. And, you know, he said, hey, you're a good skater. Let's get you in a ref's uniform and get you in the mix here.
He must not have watched you too closely if he called you a good skater.
Exactly. It's just good pivots, you know, C cuts all day.
Well, that's awesome, right? I mean, it goes down to the fact of lessons that you learn as a goalie transfer over into life and to this opportunity. You never know who's going to be in the building. You never know who's going to be watching. You never know when that opportunity is going to come. But when it is, you have to be ready for it. And it sounds like you were able to embrace the opportunity that was given to you, rise to the occasion and show off your skills as a ref. I'm sure that you have some good stories, and we'll jump into that a little bit later. Before we get to the reffing side, I think it'd be interesting to kind of talk about your path, right? You're a local kid. You said you grew up in the Hollydale area. What are some of the tier one organizations that you grew up playing in this area before you moved on to juniors?
So my first shot at tier one was at Team Comcast. I was there under Jared Beach and Tom Plungis, who I don't think coaches anymore. But, you know, they gave me, a lot of work that day. I started my way as a backup, which was something new to me. I didn't even think there were starters and backups, in tier one. I just kind of thought you flip-flopped every game or, shared everything. I'm a first-generation hockey guy in my family. So kind of a new thing for me. So a little adversity there. I just kind of took it on the nudge. Never really worked out. Before that time, I was 16. Started getting in the gym, working out, paying attention more to my athleticism, reflexes, and really studying the game. I started watching a lot more NHL hockey, talking to my buddies that were already out playing junior hockey in the USHL, the Ontario League, and stuff like that. And it all kind of fell into place. It didn't hurt to get a nice 4-inch growth spurt that year either. So like I said, it's started out, I got lit my absolute first game. I think I lost 6 or 7 goals against Kyle Palmieri and the New Jersey Colonials. So that was a taste of reality here, that it was a different mix, and, fight your way up. Ended up winning the starting job through that season, and then, returned for one more year.
So you're telling me you didn't play tier one till you were 16?
Correct.
So you weren't doing all this when you were 9 years old, 10 years old, 11 years old, and you still were able to make it to the NCAA?
Yeah, it's funny story. I'm sure we all know the Flyer skate zone in Voorhees. I can't even remember. Maybe fourth grade, third grade maybe. First day of school, I was really excited. Got my new Under Armour backpack, just came out those days. Super excited to get the Nike swoosh, shirt on and getting ready to, talk to the first girl I saw. And never happened that part. But anyway, long story short, my dad said, hey, you know what? I think we got another thing on the calendar today. So he took me to Flyer Skate Zone. It was the opening day, Flyers, Philadelphia Flyers practice. Ended up meeting Brian Boucher, Keith Primo, Rick Tockett, John LeClaire, Chris Therrien, a lot of guys that live around here and coach as well and have their sons in the mix with our tier one community. And it just worked out. My dad got me a Mylick goalie mask the day before and played against sports. So they all signed that. I'll sign my little Flyers jersey and stuff like that. So, that was a story that kind of motivated me from day one just to see A, how hard these guys work, B, the crowds that they bring in, and, how passionate other people are of the sport, C, just how excited my dad was to be around those guys as well, and, overall, just being able to work with those guys later down the line.
Yeah. I mean, the point I wanted to make was you found a lot of success, and you weren't chomping at the bit. I'm sure you may have been, but not – jumping at the first opportunity to break down that wall to tier one, right? There's a time and place. And one of the things that I want to discuss, and maybe me and Mitch will do this next week, we were tossing around ideas, is talk about, a generic path timeline of when you should be moving up and making your adjustments. Obviously, there's plus or minuses to either side for when you should be doing it. But, you know, I think a generic path, the NCAA and possibly pro, we can go through that path. I mean, some kids and some goalies that are on this call actually are going through this process now. Should I make this jump? Should I go and try out or put my name in a hat and possibly get placed on a tier one team this year? Is that the best for me? Does that make sense? And everybody always has their different reasons of making that adjustment to tier two to tier one. But just so everybody knows that if you don't make it early, like if you're not in the cool group or the small good boys club early, you're not technically behind the curve too much. Right. Another good example of that is somebody that I'm sure that you know, Mason, TJ Brennan. And you guys might know that name. He's one of the best defensemen in the AHL for the last number of years. He was one of the leading scorers as a defenseman in the AHL. He grew up in the Jersey area, played juniors at Little Flyers, and then got drafted, I believe, in the O or the Q. I can't remember which one. And then he got drafted, and then he's playing pro. He didn't start hockey till he was 15. And again, you know, he played 1 year tier two, then the next year he played juniors, and then, you know, he skyrocketed. So everyone has their own path. Don't rush into something until you're ready. You want to play at the highest level possible, but at the same time, if you're not at that tier one level yet, A, first and foremost, if your skill wise isn't there yet, or B, if there's just not any opportunities, don't think it's the end all be all. You can still reach your goals. Mason went to college, NCAA. He's reffing in the AHL. You can reach very high plateaus in your career if you're patient, you have faith, and if you're good enough. At the end of the day, you have to be good enough. Whether you're good enough at 12 really doesn't mean much whenever it comes down to trying to climb the ladder. So now after you kind of did your stint in the area, you said you went away to play juniors. How did that come about? Where did you play? Why don't you tell us a little story or give us some insights on that front?
So like I said, the tier one in the local market, you know, obviously you do a lot of tournaments in Boston. We went to Chicago, things of that nature. Coaches start chattering. Basically ended up being approached by a team in the Manitoba Junior Hockey League. It was a short stint, about 3 months, until my first injury. So I tore my knee out there, but basically you get out there, you know, I didn't even know what Manitoba was at the time, you know, or really what junior hockey was. You know, my coaches kind of groomed me in on it, said, you know, here's XYZ, what they're really going to be looking for, get into better shape, go in there, fight for your spot. It's going to be scrimmages. I went in there pretty much looking for a guarantee that I was going to play. And my goalie partner, Chris Ward, just got back from Edmonton in the WHL. So he was an overager that year. Fantastic family. You know, he was a great mentor to me, kind of walked me through the ins and outs as a 20-year-old in junior hockey, which at the time it seems like, oh my gosh, this guy's aging, right? Until you're that 20-year-old in junior hockey. So like I said, it was fantastic. A lot of adversity, especially a kid from New Jersey going in the middle of nowhere. We were about 5.5 hours north of Winnipeg, which is pretty up there as it is.
Warm in the winter, huh? Real warm up there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's you pretty much just go in the middle of nowhere. A lot of these teams are, you know, we played team Weiwei Sikaput Wolverines, Dauphin Kings, things that team, like you never really know who you're up against or, you know, what the skill set is. You have guys, you know, as young as you are, you know, that made the same path go in. And then you've got guys that played on top tier, tier one teams in Canada and the US since they were six. So it's just at the end of the day, when you get in there, your first day camp, and you know, you're always fighting for a spot, right? That's the thing about junior hockey, is it's not like you sign a contract when you're, you know, when you're 6, 12, up to 18 years old and your parents pay your fee. It's, you know, you're playing for free. You're, you know, you're battling every day to get better. There's people always watching you. Your coaches are always talking about you to colleges and other schools. You know, it's one of those things where you really just got to hit the grindstone. And, you know, unfortunately, it didn't last the whole year for me because I did tear my knee. But you know, it's, you know, I came home, I got the surgery. I went back, you know, just couldn't cut it again. Right. So I needed more time to rehab. I ended up, you know, leading on to that, I signed in the NA3HL, for the Quad City, Flames, in Iowa. I had a great group of guys around me. Same thing, started as a backup. So going from tier two Canadian League to the NA3HL, you know, I kind of had a high head on my shoulders and was thinking I was better than anybody else. But you know what? I sat the bench for the first four or five games till I got my chance. I ran with it, and then shoulder pops out. So I have to leave again. So that's, you know, I ended up being fortunate enough to go back there. I trained with Maddie in the summer, you know, just head to the grindstone. I played maybe 40 games of junior hockey in 2 years. And, you know, that's where, you know, I started having to worry about, am I going to play again, right? So at the end of the day, it's just, you never know what you're going to be up against or who you're going to be up against. It's just, doesn't matter who you are or where you're at, just give it your all, right? Just as long as you're working hard, absorb all the lessons and little techniques that are being shared with you. Study the game, implement it in your game. What works, perfect. What doesn't, tweak it on your own or with some guidance from your coaches. And, you know, I have faith in you guys too, just like myself. It worked out. I ended up getting, at the time, to Northland College. So that was, you know, I thought the dream was done. I came back. I played, I think, five games for the Little Flyers and committed my second game. So it really proved just right place, right time. Is and hard work just gets you where you need to be.
So that's a good segue, Mason. So, I mean, obviously for juniors, you had a lot of physical, emotional, mental battles that you got through, which obviously all make you stronger. How did you get to Northland? What else? I mean, what was part of that process? Because a lot of these guys, we have some younger guys here who eventually will be going through this process. How did you end up at Northland? Were there other schools you were looking at? And then I know, then talk a little bit. I know you were there for 2 years and then transferred back east to University of New England.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. It was one of those things where, you know, they take into account SAT scores. It's you have to get into college first, right? You don't think, even though it's in the NCAA, they do take things such as character, grade point average, SAT scores into consideration, right? You're not, it's not a Friday Night Lights or Mystery Alaska kind of scenario. You know, these are real people. You're going into a community in itself, whichever campus you guys end up having the luxury to go to. For me, it was, you know, Northland was a smaller school. Like I said, moving to Canada, moving to Iowa, I like that smaller community vibe. You know, they had a half decent business program. They were in a fantastic conference, the NCHC, playing, you know, schools like St. Norbert and Adrian College, all, you know, I think our conference my freshman year going into it, we had six of the top 10 teams in the nation in our conference alone. So I wanted to get in that mix, and it was a up-and-coming growing program. They just did a huge addition on campus. You know, it just seemed like a great fit at the time. And I went for it. I moved out there. And again, it was right on the northern tip of Lake Superior, a little bit northeast of Duluth, Minnesota. And it was a fantastic 2 years.
So what happened after those 2 years? What made you come back to back east to another warm school, by the way?
Sure. Yeah, exactly. It was once you get a taste of the negative 32 degree winters after the wind chill and all that stuff, you know, obviously life happens, right? I had a couple nephews here. It was one of those things where I was starting to get it. You know, obviously you're playing Division III, right? So the NHL is a little further away from when you're a 17-year-old kid moving to Canada. So I took into consideration, you know, obviously family life. Wanted to kind of groom that back and get to know my nephews and things of that sort. So a bit of personal right there. But it's, you know, University of New England had approached me before. I didn't have the grades to get in. They just built a $30 million arena on campus. It's right on the coast of Maine, you know, just south of Portland, just north of UNH. So one of my best friends was playing at UNH at the time, along with a couple of buddies I worked out in summer with. So it was just a fresh start. They had a fantastic business program, you know, which I translated, worst comes to worst, hockey doesn't work out, I'll walk away with a fantastic degree. So, which ended up being the case. So all my box were checked. You know, I did it, transferred, pulled up on campus, lived in a nine bedroom villa, with eight teammates right on the ocean. It was a fantastic time. I met my wife. Crowd was great every single night. You know, our training facilities were fantastic. Our trainers, you know, working out every day in the morning. There's a lot more structure on those kind of schools. We were nationally ranked at a few points of the season, and just came just shy of making it to the NCAA finals, like the championships, my senior year.
So just so we can recap all this, because as a person who knows your story, it's pretty amazing, right? I mean, you're not very stereotypical or the generic path that everyone thinks they have to take. I mean, you didn't start tier one till you were 16, and you played juniors, had a bunch of injuries. You were pretty much a suitcase, no offense, right? All over the place, right? Picking up, traveling, moving your life all over the place, putting life on hold, playing hockey till you're 20, 21, then going to a school, which obviously is a goal to play NCAA, but oh my goodness, now this one doesn't work out. It's not the best for you. And then finally you find your home at the final destination, and you have a great career there for the 2 years, a lot of fun. Obviously propelled you into the human being that you are today. You know, along the way, what kept you motivated? Because there's some people that I know that I coach, Mitch, I'm sure you have some of them that you coach as well. Mason, I'm sure that there's been some teammates that you've been around that you see people battle those type of emotions or that adversity, but then they tuck their tail between their legs, they run home, and they look for excuses or reasons why to quit. What kept you motivated? Why'd you put and sacrifice all that just to get to, you know, NCAA Division III?
Sure. You know, it's a multitude of things, right? I would say when it comes down to it, my competitive nature, you know, I hate to lose, you know, even today. It's one of those things. It's, you know, I may not have always been the best player or ref or coach or anything like that. But at the end of the day, I've always held my head high and, you know, admittedly so, nobody's going to outwork me. So it's one of those things where, you know, yeah, it's adversity, and, you know, don't get me wrong, guys. There's times where I wanted to quit, and, you know, I said, all right, well, maybe this isn't going to work out. You know, there's other things. But at the end of the day, it's, you know, I knew that's what I wanted to do. I've had literally the majority of my best friends have been guys I've played with or against in my life. And it's the hockey world's so small, I'm sure you heard that. But at the end of the day, I just always wanted to be in the mix. I knew I could do it to some extent. And it wasn't going to be a lack of trying that I didn't make it, you know, so they say. So at the end of the day, just really work ethic, you know, and pride, I would say.
I think pride's a good word. You have to be prideful of yourself, you know, hold yourself accountable and trust that you can get to where you want to. I mean, we all want to stay positive, but we all have that, you know, our angel and then our devil, and sometimes the devil is a little bit louder than the other person that's kind of helping you push yourself to reach those goals. One question from Jacob: can you talk more about the school atmosphere and balancing hockey and academics in college?
Sure. I think it varies depending on where you go. You know, there's some schools that are newer that are trying to build some sort of chemistry or a program itself. There's other schools that have been established and have won national championships or have come close. I think basically as far as schoolwork goes along with college, you know, you're not getting paid for it, right? But it is more of a job. You know, you're recruited for a reason. And obviously us being goalies, your job is to stop the puck. So, you know, a lot of the times you'll have early morning workouts, you know, right before class. Which if you have an 8 a.m. class, okay, well, you're in the gym by 5:30, you know, 5:30, 6 o'clock. You know, you do your reps, you do it to the best of your ability. You know, there's always goals set for you. So, you know, whether it be lifting weights or, you know, speed tests on the ice, things like that. We did fitness testing all throughout the season. We had a great program for what's it called? Physiotherapy, and trainer, athletic training. So they were highly involved in our program specifically. So we would test every other month, on and off the ice. So it was A, try and beat your max from the other, from your former tests. B, obviously get better on the ice. Every day, obviously you practice, normally we practice, in the afternoon, right at 4:30. We'd have our goalie session, and then at 5 o'clock, we jump on for an hour or two of practice. So after that, obviously comes, the grunt force of the work. What's due tomorrow or what's due next week? What can I kind of chalk up to the bit here? You know, a lot of hours on the MacBook Pro. my parents still say that's the only thing that got me through college was that computer. So, but outside of that, it's just really, you know, you're a student athlete, right? So you're a student first and an athlete second. You're there, you know, obviously they take into consideration team GPA. Everybody contributes, right? So on and off the ice, you want to be the best teammate you can be. You learn a lot about time management, and management of yourself. And you learn a lot about your mental and physical limits when both are combined at once.
Yeah. Before I let Mitch jump in, because I know he's got a question, one point I want to bring up for you guys, like when you guys are on a high-level team, whether juniors or college, there are those off-ice testing things that you have to be conscious of. But just remember, no matter what you do, you're always lumped together. Whenever you're with a team, whether one kid on the team or everybody does something right or wrong, you always get painted with the same brush. So when you're at the university or at college, hockey players like to have fun, right? We enjoy our buddies. We work hard. And then usually we like to hang out and have a little bit of fun. Whenever you guys are going to do that in an environment, be conscious of what you're doing and be conscious what your teammates are doing, because one stupid decision here or there could be the end of everything. Could be the end of everything. So make sure you're being conscious of what you're doing, making sure you understand what you're representing, not just the name on the back, but the logo on the front, the university, the hockey program, your teammates, your coaches, your parents, the team, the players that have come before you. Respect it and have pride in that. Mitch, jump into the question that you wanted to ask. Sorry.
Yeah, for sure. But one other quick thing there with talking, especially being a student athlete, and Mason touched on how the team is a team goal for have a team GPA goal. I mean, I'm sure you had it at Newman. We have it at Bernathen. You don't want to be that guy that if you miss that GPA goal, you don't want to be that guy because everyone knows. So just make sure you are a student athlete. It is very important that we work or focus on those academics.
Yeah.
But let's segue into the strikes. Let's segue into your officiating. So I guess my first question for you is why ref versus linesman?
It honestly wasn't my choice. I started out a linesman. I thought that was my thing. I'm 6 foot two. The standard of a linesman back in the day was, you know, 6 foot one and above, you're a linesman, right? So just like that, like I said, I was a linesman when I was seen by the NHL during the NCAA game. I walk into the NHL officiating combine. Both the bosses come up to me, pull me aside, say, hey, you know, really glad you made it. What do you want to be? My response, I just want to be part of it. You know, it's we all know it's, you know, the refs, especially in a linesman, are an afterthought when it comes to hockey. I hated the refs and linesmen, I'll be honest. And like I said, my competitive nature put me against those guys all the time. And it got me into some trouble in both junior and college. So at the end of the day, I said, you know, I don't really mind. Whatever gets me more ice and more games, you know, that's what I'm here to do, is fight to be whatever you guys see me as. They said, well, you're going to be a ref. So they said, you're loud out there, you know, you skate well, you know, you communicate very well with the players, especially the goalies. So that's going to be your path here.
You know, so your path as a ref is kind of funny, because I do remember watching you play, and you were never one to shy away from getting inside the ref's ear. So, you know, coaching at a higher level, any good stories of you getting what you earned whenever you gave ref some ear from the younger days?
Sure. Like me yelling at the refs as a player? For sure. Just so happens junior year at University of New England. You know, I was a starting goalie. You know, it worked out to the fact that I got a couple or unwanted knees to the face, a couple consecutive whistles in a row. I throw one back, you know, little closed glove hand to the chest. Ref calls a penalty on me. So I said, okay, well, just like obviously you got to be a good teammate. I put my team down. I got lit. Let in the first shot on the power play. Guy came across the crease, took me out, empty net goal. That's when the temper started to flare. I, you know, good old Curtis Joseph flipped up the bucket, went to the corner. Are you a couple choice words? So on and so forth. I got bounced. I got suspended for a game. So I've had a couple goalies do that to me too. Obviously the American League, there's a lot of European goalies. So you have no idea what those guys are saying 90% of the time. Especially, a goalie in Stockton, California, my best friend's team, Buddy Robinson, it was the one game I was looking forward to all year. I can't even pronounce the guy's name. Something with a Z, Russian guy, younger kid in net. Nobody even near him. He still comes after me. It's 2-0 at this point in the third. Starts losing his mind in Russian. And I actually kind of thought about the time where I started, freaking out on the refs. Just said, hey, goal's going to stand. Sorry, nothing we can review.
Yeah, that's actually what I want to point out. So now that you're on the opposite side of it, do you have a little bit more of a longer leash for goalies because you feel for them? Or are you one that you rule with an iron fist? Because you have to.
I would like to. Honestly, I'm a goalie guy, through and through. That's my passion, obviously, every day. Even above reffing, I still, love goaltending. It's one of those things where you wish you can give them an extra arm and a leg in there and, maybe a couple wave-offs. But at the end of the day, it's a business, right? So, there's a couple ones. I think the only penalty I called this year, goalie interference, was I gave two for Corey Schneider in one game. He got pushed in Binghamton. Puck caroms off the backboards off his pad, rebound comes out. Guy kind of, brushes him with the shoulder, so he says, right to the head, no goal, get in the box here. The next one, it's the next play on that one. Guy slew foots him, no goal. So that was that would have been the game-winning goal right there going into OT. There was about a minute left. So obviously the crowd's going nuts and, the coaches are going nuts. It's you got to do what you got to do. And it was, Corey Schneider's a fantastic guy. He'll talk to anybody. And, we've had dinner a couple of times. But at the end of the day, it's a business, right? So I'm there to be the ref. I got to be the ref.
Yeah. You're held to a high standard too, because just like players, they watch video, your higher ups were watching you and watching video of you to make sure that you're doing your job, exactly. Which I think is a good kind of segue in, Mitch. I know that we have some clips of some game situational stuff, which obviously for those who don't know, we're all in this together. Mason, Mitch, and I all work together with you guys that sometimes we get out on your practices or you guys see us in camps or clinics. Not too often do we get all three of our minds together to watch video. So we have some good clips. Mitch is going to pull up a couple segments. I'll let you have the screen. And then what I would like to do is go through the video with everybody. We'll talk about it and we'll have a discussion. Before we jump into that, Jacob just typed in a nice chat. So moving up levels at goalie, you have to slow the game down. In reffing, I've noticed you have to do the same. How do you slow the game down from the reffing side?
Great question. Just like goaltending, it's about positioning, right? We all know who the top players are. You take your game notes, their tendencies. Same thing for reffing. We do a ton of film every single day. We have clips sent to us. We have, we're always watching each other's games. We're watching our games time and time again. at the end of the day, reffing, same thing, positioning. Utilizing your C cuts, those bigger strides to get out of the way, keeping your eye on the puck, and also using your outside vision just to focus on the little ticky-tack penalties. So at the end of the day, it's kind of the same thing as goaltending. I think that's what's helping me out in reffing. You have to be at the right spot, the right time, in and out of the rink. And really just break it down, have confidence in your game too. That helps a lot. Because if you go, you always have to have the right mindset, whether it's going into a youth game, junior game, college game, have confidence in your ability. Even though it's my first year, from day one, it's just been one of those things where I was able to, realize where I needed to be, what I have to do, and, adjust when adversity comes.
Excellent. Well, Mitch, you got, I think you got hosting rights, so you want to pull up some video, watch the video?
Let me see if I can't, for some reason, it's not pulling up my claw. There we go. Okay.
All right. So, guys, as we go through, what we're going to do is we're going to watch a couple clips. Let's watch I think we have a clip broken down at full speed and then half speed after. And then if you don't mind, can we hit pause after we watch a full speed and half speed?
Yep. So just a little preface. So I have to give credit. The video came from GDI's camp last year that I attended. It was a very high level camp out in Green Bay at the Green Bay Gamblers facility, which was phenomenal.
Beautiful.
What the theme of the entire week was, there's certain ways that goals go in. And today's theme we're doing is in zone. So these are all plays, whether it be on power play or not, that develop with a puck being in the zone. So not on a rush, not off a rebound. This play strictly coming from in the zone. And these are all goals from the playoffs from 2018, 2019. These are all the goals scored. So if you stay with us over the next couple of weeks, you're going to see every goal scored in those playoffs. So here we go.
So as we watch, obviously, I want you guys to pay attention to the whole play. And then after each clip, we'll watch a full speed and half speed. I'm going to propose a question to the group. And if you can, I want you guys to try and answer it in the chat. All right.
That's the last view. Do you want to see that again, or?
Yeah, let's watch it one more time, and I'll propose my question. So as we're watching this, I want you all to find one deficiency with the goaltender. So find one piece that he could have done better, and I want you to type it up for me. Because it's a good shot. All right, so we have from Evan Miller, we have went down too early. Jacob, we have he slid for the pass across the ice. Patrick, he is too low, which makes it hard for him to move. Rhino, his screenplay, he doesn't look around it. Okay. Hank, leaned too far over. Mason, what do you think?
I think there's a variety of things here. First off, I don't think he saw the screen necessarily coming. So I don't think he took that into consideration that they needed to, keep his upper body a bit more approach towards the puck, right? You always want to present your body, especially towards the screen. Him going so far forward, he brings his arms back, opening up more holes, and he ultimately gets burned.
Mitch, what's your take? Because obviously, just like we talked about Justin, everyone sees something differently and we communicate it all differently. I think we're all similar in the realm of saying things that are very similar. But what's your take?
So my biggest thing, and I think where Vassy really loses this, and I'm about to – I rewound it just to this spot, is this pass – I mean, if we're looking at where everyone is, we've got our puck carrier over here, we have our threats over here, and we have our threat here, and we have our screen. This pass is going across. What's the first thing that he does? Does he get there on his feet or does he drop? And I think as soon as he drops, I think he realizes that he made a horrible mistake, tries to get up, and at that point, it's done. At that point, if he's down, I'd almost rather him stay stay down, because as soon as he comes up, he's done.
I mean, I think that obviously it's a power play. It's a quick play. The guy comes across. We got a couple bodies in front with a good release at a high percentage scoring opportunity, and he nips it, right? A high blocker side, it looks like. I think, Mitch, you touched on a good point. I think it was a misread. I don't think he intentionally went down. I think it was the default. I don't know where the puck is. Oh, I see an opportunity, and he never caught back up. You know, Mason touched on a few points about his positioning and his balance. You know, as we're going through here, I think it comes down to a lot of things. A, we can control what we can. One, that guy in front of that screen, especially on a power play, he's going to be there. You have to be able to manage that, and it doesn't look like he managed that screen very well. So, Rhino, good pickup. I also think that they need to have better communication as a defensive unit to not allow that pass to go through. When I coached and all the coaches I played for, you want to give a power play to the perimeter. That's okay. But you don't want to have passes slice across your box or your diamond. So, yes, it's a good shot. Yes, it's a good release. I think it's a fault of the PK. But also, we had our goalie default down, try and recover, be off balance, and not be able to see the puck. All good stuff. All right, let's watch the next one. It's a good shot, too.
It is a good shot. Okay, we got Washington, Carolina.
All right, stop it right here. Before we get going, who scores for the Capitals? I want everyone to try and guess. So Ovi's set up in his spot, which obviously everyone is teed up on always and aware of. But you're going to be a little bit surprised. Let's watch it. You want to press play there, Mitch?
I did.
Oh.
Is it not playing?
Oh, it's coming. It just might be my internet. All right, so again, slow-mo. All right, so as we go through here, what is something that he could have done better? Because obviously this is, again, a power play goal, back door, but what is something that he could have done a little bit better to help possibly make that save? So Rhino says push out to puck, not to post. Jacob says cut the pass through the crease. Evan says just watch the back door. Hank says came forward so he couldn't move faster. Patrick says he never shoulder checks. All right, so let's watch again.
So first of all, did anyone guess Backstrom scored?
No one guessed Backstrom scored. Well, which is understandable. That's why I wanted to put it out there. Ovi's such a big target, and that spot is so prolific for him that sometimes you can see. Look at 22. He's not even that worried about Backstrom because you can see he's like, oh no, if they go to Ovi, I got to get out there. So he's giving that option, that backdoor option, because he respects Ovi even more. Mason, what do you think? I think who's in that? Is this?
That's Mrazek.
Mrazek,
I believe.
What do you think? Bring high all the way across from Seth. Okay.
Yeah, I think I don't think he respects the shooter enough right there. Obviously, he's already on his post. You know, it's a tough angle. I think if he moves, you know, even if he just cuts out a couple inches just to stay true to that shot, obviously it's a lefty shot, right? So there's no way he's picking that corner if he comes out or if he stays deep. At least you hope not. It's happened before. But that too, I think obviously somebody said it, the shoulder check. You know, I think Backstrom's a lefty, right? Am I reading that correctly?
Yes. Yep.
You know, obviously you got to stay true to your mark. The puck's over there towards the boards. I think you got to come out there a bit more. That gives you the opportunity to cut off that pass or stay on your feet, cut out if he goes to Oshie or goes back, you know, tries to cycle up top.
Yeah, what do you think, Mitch?
Yeah, so a couple of things. I think one, and I don't like to blame D, but I'm blaming D here because whoever this is here, we've got two guys defending Oshie on a power play. 11's right here, and we have our defenseman right here. Why are we both – if this pass happens to come to Oshie, which chances are it's not, 11 has that covered. So all this guy should be focusing on is this pass going across, or you have this guy on the back who's worrying about Ovi. But where I'll put the blame on Mrazek is 2 points. Number one is I do believe that he doesn't respect the shooter at all, as he's way deep in that crease. But the one thing that I'll also point out is that pass goes across the top of that crease. This is the perfect time for a little poke check to get rid of that pass. Because I like to say, and I know a lot of goalies here, Rhino hears it all the time, the easiest save to make is the one you don't have to make. And in my opinion, he doesn't have to make this save. That's a simple extension poke check, and that puck's out of the zone, probably out and maybe even a faceoff.
Notice, too, just to add on that as well, notice how deep that C-cut was, right, on Mrazek. That guy's a lefty shot. Why would he go C-cut his right foot all the way back to the goal line and push across to that other post, right?
The guys that joined the call with DK, there was a similar situation, not technically a backdoor pass, but we saw one against DK where he generated a backdoor option from himself off of a rebound. And we talked about him being aggressive and attacking pucks. I think how do you pronounce this guy's name?
Mrazek.
Duh. He played for the
Flyers. He only played in Philly there, Matt.
I know. I forgot. I never really liked him anyway. But either way, that's neither here nor there. He comes across. His right leg is his lead leg. He drops that. But he never brings his left shoulder or his left hip. His five hole stays open. So he doesn't really have that drive or that attack to the save. But when you guys were talking here, I think he's playing this situation fine, to be honest. I think you need to be on the goal line right here. If anybody beats an NHL goalie from the outside hash mark, pretty much close to the boards, even if you're on the goal line, you shouldn't be in the NHL or you misuse an RVH. That's it, right? So there's no rhyme or reason for me to be overly aggressive on the shooter here. He's not dangerous in my eyes. Oshie is dangerous. Backstrom is dangerous. So if he throws a puck on the net, you have to hold your square and be able to control that shot, which you're going to be able to. If he moves that pass to Oshie right away, if you guys watch the Capitals a lot, that is a play that they use often, where Oshie pops, sets up for the one-timer, gets an on his stick, off the stick. That's a hard save to make. That backdoor option to Backstrom, even more challenging and difficult. And again, if you look here, the defense is in good coverage. Mitch, you brought up a great point. Yes, the pass that gets across is on twofold. It's a 3-on-3. That's what you want. The other two guys on the power play, the 2 points, let them be on the perimeter. I don't care even if you're going against Ovi. If he's shooting from where he normally is shooting, you're supposed to stop it. Ovi's a hell of a shooter. He's one of the greatest scorers ever to play the game, especially for this era. He's going to score goals, but the expectation is for you to stop it. This little 3-on-3 from the hash marks down, this needs to be controlled not only by the goaltender, but by the defensive zone coverage of the forwards and the D. Once that pass happens, Mitch touched on it, a good active stick could eliminate that pass altogether. But if that pass does go through, we have to attack that puck. He's in too tight. You don't need to just block because you can see where his blade's at. Once that pass leaves that player's stick from the boards going across that crease to Backstrom, his stick is going to accept that pass. That's where you start attacking. And if you can beat that pass to that spot and cover up as much net as possible, there's no space for him to score. But if you sit back, you just try and take up space, you allow the puck to get on top of you, then you allow some of these players that are the best players in the world pick you apart. Now, the level that most of you guys are playing against is you don't have to be as fine-tuned as these guys, but it's a good teaching tool. Perfect. Let's watch the next one. And again, you know, if you look at that, it's a little bit deceiving from that release and that backdoor pass. He could have expected maybe a shot there, especially with that release. All right, let's watch another one. All right, 6-on-5 here. All right, so this is a good example of a screenplay. When we're looking at this goal, is this something that he could have stopped or should have stopped. And remember the difference between the two. Could have stopped is obviously every puck is stoppable. Should have stopped, it's a bad goal, and it's his fault for going in. What do you guys think? And Hank, okay, so Miller says he could have stopped it. Hank says he was not square. Jacob says, because of the shooter, not totally set on shooter. Sorry, because of the screen, not totally set on shooter, but not his fault. Could have had blocker higher for Seth. Patrick says he needed to look for the puck, look where the puck was and didn't know where it was. All right. So, Mason, you're a bigger body guy. You played juniors, you played college. You know, as you climb the ladder, that's kind of one of the big differentiators between the levels is not only the skill and the speed, but the net front presence. You know, how did you deal with screens and what advice could you give Robert Leonard here to maybe mix in a save in this situation?
Sure. I mean, some people would say he's being lazy. You know, he's not set or anything like that. I think he's set fine. I think when you bubble it down, there's so many bodies moving so quick and the puck's just being whipped around. Let's be honest, it's the NHL. I think that's, I don't know what number four's name is, but
Schultz maybe?
Could be. You know, these are big guys. That's a heavy shot, right? I think he misreads his stride there. Obviously he's backing up. He lines up. If you look at it where he's about to wind up, right behind number 15, that's where he's truly square right now, it looks to me. But him drifting back that extra, you know, say 7-8 inches, that's what opens up that right side of the net there, right? So Robin Leonard, I don't think that he necessarily anticipated that drift of the D-man. And I don't know, who knows, maybe he even thought it would hit number 24 in front of him. I just don't think he saw it, and I don't think he was, you know, as aggressive as he should be that deep in the net. I think he could have been a couple inches out, at least toes to the blue.
All right, Mitch, what's your take?
Yeah, I mean, I'm right with Mason on this. I think that he's just too deep in his crease. I know Leonard is a big guy and he plays deep, but I think this is a situation. And Matt, we've talked about the last couple of sessions. You know, this is a 3-2 hockey game in the closing seconds. This is where you need your clutch goalie to come up with a save to secure a win and not have this game go into overtime. Yes, it's 6-on-5, and yes, Malkin's out there, and yes, Crosby's out there. But to me, this is a save that Leonard's got to make. If he's going to be considered an elite goalie, and I think it all comes to depth. I think if his toes are at the top of the crease, I think just with his size, this puck probably hits him. The fact that I believe this puck gets some short side, so he actually kind of misread it, leaned a little bit off to the other side. But I think that's just depth. I think he's got to have, with the screen there, toes on the top of the crease and let his body just absorb that puck.
I love that you brought up the game situation, because that's what I was going to touch on. And that's why I wanted this one to be a should have or could have. If we're taking everything else away from this moment, he could have had it, right? Maybe not should have had it. He could have had it. There's a good screen in front. It's a great release. He picks the top corner short side. But if you look at the situation, first round of playoffs, game one, you're winning 3-1 with less than a minute left. You need to have this save, right? So there's a difference between the two. And goalies need to have that understanding, right? Whenever you're looking at yourself and you're reading your own play, you need to not only just look at the underlying details of how goals went in, why it went in, but you need to understand the full situational awareness of it, whether it makes a difference when you made that save or when it went in. So you look at him, Mason touched on it, big body guys, a lot of variables, a lot of guys moving across the crease. It's a good shot. He doesn't see it. It goes in. Mitch, you brought on it. He's a little bit deep. You know, he shifted his body weight more towards the middle. You can see his body weight kind of lag more towards his center, and he gets nipped short side. When I was being taught how to handle screens, I'm a small goalie. I have to battle through big body guys, 6'5" guys plus 200 plus, finding a lane, seeing pucks. If I was going to default, or if I was going to have a order of importance, I needed to protect that short side. I always needed to. I knew I did. I knew I had to. Short side, why? It's the shortest distance between 2 points, between that shooter's puck and the net. That means you have the least amount of time to react. So if I protect just a little bit more on that short side, and if he does go far side, I have a half second longer to catch up. That doesn't mean you're always going to catch up, and that doesn't mean that you're always going to make every save. But if I was going to default, if I was going to shift to one side versus the other, I was going to shift to that short side because you have less time to read and react. Let's watch the next one. All right. All right, so I'm going to call out Jacob. Let's go, Snellenberg. Give me your take in the chat here. What's actually, you know what? Let's see if, can you empower him to have his mic on? I want to hear your take on this one.
See if I can do that. I believe I can.
You're the host.
Yep.
All right, Jacob, tell me your insight on this one.
First of all, not really to do with the goal. I don't really understand when the puck's behind the net, why he's down the entire time when his own team has the puck.
Sure. Thank you.
Kind of just tiring himself out the entire time. But once the puck comes out, he almost looks a little surprised, and he comes out really far, not really identifying the guy back door. I mean, he's a pretty big guy as well, so I feel like if he wants to come out that far, because it is a pretty straight-on shot, then, like, toes should probably be at the top of the red, and he should already be looking. Like, I feel like he played it a little too true. And then he has to anticipate that that's happening. Like, the guy's looking at the pass. He's not even really reading shot. So I feel like he has to anticipate it a little bit more, if that makes sense.
Sure. I think that was a good overall view of the situation. Let's pass to Mason. Mason, any insight or what's your take on this one?
Sure. I think there's two sides of the coin here. Looking at from visual one, A, understanding that he's a European goalie. He's, 6'5", 6'6"? That's his style of play, right? So obviously the RVH transitions, that's his game. And he's obviously had a very successful career doing it. He knows how to read that play, let's be honest here. I think from that sense, he drifts back too quick, right? He's never truly set. He comes out, starts going back. He's really wide. Kind of try and bait the shot. At the same time, I just don't think he truly picks up that guy back door. He's too far deep to get over, to get his leg or stick or whatever he can get right in front of that stick plate to block that shot. From a different mindset, I think, A, you know, him moving so much delays him from getting set, and that's why he gets burned. And him coming out so late, he can't visually get set.
You know, watching the whole clip and then seeing the time, it is 18 minutes left on the clock in the second period, right? So this could possibly be the first time that Dallas with a puck is in zone for the second period for Pekka, right? So everyone's harping on him about being down so much. And I agree. I don't think you need to be down. So I'm going to always be the devil's advocate. I think he's still trying to get warmed up as a period started and ripping through, you know, some simple movements when he knows it's not in a dangerous environment to get comfortable again. And then all of a sudden you have a defensive zone breakdown. And then next thing you know, it's in the back of the net. You know, this, when the period starts, you have to get yourself rocking and rolling and moving quick. You know, once that puck drops, you have to be 100% focused and back in. You know, sometimes you get a couple whistles before you get a shot and you can move around, skate, and do a little bit of extra stretching. And sometimes you don't. So I'm not sure if he was over committing early or just trying to get warmed back up after he spent 20 minutes in the locker room. But now after that, I think it is really moot. It doesn't really affect the play that much. He gets off the post, back to his feet. You can see right here, good positioning, top of the crease. You can see the shooter. right? Now, as she's coming in, you have to be able to dissect all these variables in a half second. Where's the shooter's feet? Where is his hips, his shoulders, his hands, his eyes? What angle is the blade? Is there a backdoor option? What is the hand of that guy driving the net? Who is it? I think it's Jamie Benn. I could be wrong, but he's driving the net. And if Jamie Benn's driving the net, I'm aware where he's at. He's already beat his defender. I don't know who the Nashville Predator is hooking him, but he's already beat. So once that play breaks down, you have to play this as a two-on-one, right? He holds his ground. The D shift over to either force a pass or a shot. If that pass comes, you have to have the understanding that you got to get across. He just gets caught flat-footed. Watch the pass, though, as well. Right, once he releases, it's almost looking like he's about to shoot, and he finalizes it with curling his wrists over just to make sure that he hits that target. So he's showing a shot and then finishes with a pass, and I think that's also why Pekka kind of gets flat-footed here. All right,
hey, can anyone explain to me why PK Subban is turning the other way?
Well, if you ask him, he's still one of the best defensemen in the league, so
that's what he says. But look at this position. His back is to the pass. I mean,
he panicked. All right. So for this play, let's watch it. And then Rhino, I want you to pick out a few details that we can discuss. Is that big buff back there? I miss him. All right. This is a pretty clear cut. Video, Rhino. Mitch, can you let Rhino talk?
Yep. Let me get him. Actually, he should be unmuted, so.
Am I unmuted?
Yes.
You're unmuted, Rhino. Floor is yours, pal.
Thanks, Coach. Restarted the play. Okay. So it looks like to me, he starts. He's on his post right there. It's fine. But when the shot comes, I feel like there's no reason for him to go down right there. He just like looks like he wasn't even ready for when the shot was there. Like when the pass happened, he didn't even think there'd be a threat there. He didn't do a shoulder check at all to see if there was a guy there or anything. So if he did a shoulder check, maybe he might have seen him. But if you look at him, he doesn't really see the guy until he gets the puck and he's shooting. It's in the back. That's my opinion.
All right. Good insight. I appreciate the your view. Coach Mitch, what do you see?
So the one thing I will say that I like is the fact that he's staying on his feet when the play's in the corner. He's not just defaulting to RVH or VH. Now the play's back here. We've got Buff with the puck. He has somewhat of a shooting lane. So the fact that our goalie back here is basically back with his foot on the post and not at the top of the crease shows me he's not really either expecting a shot or respecting a shot. And if Buff puts one on net, that's probably going in. So then the play comes back down. Again, he's deep, but now he's okay with where that puck is. I mean, to me, to be honest, I mean, I'm not sure if he saw where 55 was. He at no point did a shoulder check. But if this puck goes top corner, I mean, that's a snipe. This is one where I think is not a should have. This is a could have. I think this is a very good goal. It's possible that he didn't know the shooter was there, but I'm not really seeing too much of that, to be honest. I think this is an example of where you tip your hat, it's a good shot. It's 3-2. It makes it 4. Ties it up at 3-3, so you'd like to see him make that save on the power play with a minute to go. But, goals happen, guys. Mason, your thoughts?
Yeah.
I agree with everything you say. I think the one thing, you can sense a small hesitation when he comes off that post towards the puck, the puck carrier. I just think he expected his D-man to pick him up. 55 was wide open, turns out. And he kind of does a little tweak, a little more adjustment, pushes out slightly too late, right off the mark, absolute nip.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good shot. You tip your hat to, I think that's Shifley, right?
Right here. See how he comes out kind of towards the dot, like kind of peaks there, and then he pushes out. So I think that's that split second is where he delayed himself.
All right, I'm going to watch it one more time, and then I'll give you my comments. See, I think he just gets beat. I think he read it right. I think he did, you know, everything that that Binnington usually does. He's controlled. I don't think he's out of control. I don't think he's off his angle too much. I think it's a great shot where you should tip your hat. You know, Mason, you're right. Probably shouldn't have been that open. But, you know, this is a pretty simple play with no screen and ample amount of time to read that release. That's stoppable to me. Great shot. You tip your hat. He sniped it. But you're in the NHL in the playoffs, so that's got to be stopped.
Right. I do agree. I think that slight hesitation, even if that was the case and what you said, that's just a good shot from a heavy shot forward in the NHL.
Yep. I mean, we can sit here as fans and say that's a great shot and also respect the shot that he has and realize that most likely it's going to go on us too. But also as coaches or goalies, we have to understand the level of expectation. Right, that is a stoppable shot. If it's unimpeded, not deflected, you have a clear line of sight, and you're able to set your feet, you got to stop it. 99.5 times in the NHL, if that's going to happen, the goalies are going to make those saves anyway. And if you don't, you won't be in the league for very long because there's definitely enough competition to be able to force those type of goalies out of the league. I mean, there's some goalies that came in the league – and you see them for 1 or 2 years and they fizzle out. And then there's other goalies that are in the league for 10 to 15 years, right? And there is a difference. You know, everyone that makes the NHL is very, very good, but there's a big difference between being very, very good and being the best, right? And we're talking about like the Henrik Lundqvist, Carey Price, Fleury, you know, those guys, we all have the pleasure to watch future Hall of Fame goalies play. And especially in the most offensive era of hockey. You know, yes, there was higher goals scored back in the Gretzky era, but if you guys watch some of that hockey, it's not the same. It's not as skilled. It's totally different. Some of the best players to ever play the game are playing the game right now. And the goalies that have transcended through hockey, not only from, you know, the clutching and grounding and the big body type of hockey into the more skilled, fast-paced type of game and found success all the way through, those are the ones that make those saves that we just watched. Those are the ones that make those saves consistently. The goalies that don't may still get opportunities and find ways to do it down the road. But if you start letting in those type of goals consistently, you won't be at your level very long. Before we kind of move on to anything else, I want to propose, is there any questions that you guys may have with Mason about his college career, junior career, reffing, or any of his insights about the video that we just watched? If you do, throw it in the chat. Mitch, do you have any questions for Mason as we kind of start to wind down here?
I do. Mason, I want you to tell us a little funny officiating story. You shared this at the clinics about a game you had to go back in college this year. Can you share that story with us?
Wait, repeat that question.
You told us a pretty funny story at the clinics about an incident you had when you had to go back into the D1 coaching ranks. Could you share that story with us?
You got to refresh my memory a little bit. Was it at arm?
You're not used to being a linesman.
Oh, yes. Yes. So it was at Army. Yes. Thanks for bringing that up, Mitch. So obviously, you know, by Christmas, I've already done, you know, I don't know, 20, 25 games in the American League, plus a few in the USHL, all as a ref. So the transition is obviously a little difficult from linesman to ref. It's a totally different job. About maybe 20 seconds into the game, Army's buzzing down, first offensive rush. I see a little hook in the hands, which, you know, the standards of penalties is a little different from Division I to pro. But I put my arm up, and I'm the linesman. So everybody thinks it's offsides. I have to wave it off. It's good. And now everybody's yelling right after. Well, why didn't you call a penalty? I don't know. I've got no idea. And if anybody's ever heard any stories of the infamous Mr. Riley behind the Army bench, that's one guy you don't want to mess up with. Turns out the it was actually against UNH. So the directors of Hockey East was there. Directors of Atlantic Hockey were there. The NHL was there. Everybody's cracking up in the stands. Everybody's confused. All while I tried to call a hooking penalty as a linesman about 15 seconds in.
That's a good way to start your roughing career. That's awesome.
That was a tough transition.
Well, as we go through, let's see here. Jacob has made the same mistake. He said, I just did that in the AAA game. So it's a common mistake. Well, as we kind of go through here, I think it'd be kind of fun. I found some video of myself, and feel free to kind of chirp away. I'm just going to put on maybe like a snippet of like 2 minutes, and then we'll see if we can find any things that I did right or I did wrong. I don't have any goals. I don't show goals against me in this video. So we'll watch it, and then we'll do a quick little synopsis of me, and then we'll kind of move along from there. So let me share this. And this is kind of fun. This is preface this. I found this on my computer. Let's see here. Can you see the South Kent versus Kent?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So this was 2004, 2005. So we're going back, you know, 15 years ago when I was in prep school. So even before, you know, I was playing juniors, I was playing prep school at the same time, which I don't know if you can do that anymore. But this was at South Kent School. So the video quality is 04-05, but there's some pretty fun saves in here too along the way. Let's see if it's going here. Did it freeze?
It did.
Hold on. Let's try this again.
2004 technology.
2004 technology or Zoom technology.
I miss how big goalie pads used to be too.
Oh, I have the Fusion pads, the Eagle Fusion pads.
Oh, yeah.
From
Ventures?
Robert Esch style.
Oh, yeah.
Those were one of my favorite set of pads.
Right?
They were big, boxy. It was pretty much like one of the first couple pads that were flat-facing pads.
Those are awesome, man.
I know. I don't know if this is going to work. I feel bad.
I had the Thomas Bokun Eagle Infinities back in the day.
Yeah. All right. So screw it. I don't know if that's going to work. Oh, hold on. One more try. All right. Nope. Oh, here we go. All right. So share. We'll go video. Share. Can you see the video?
Yeah.
So it's full screen or no?
Yep.
Sleep.
Okay, cool. All right, so I just kind of jumped somewhere in the middle. So as we're going, I was pretty athletic. I was kind of all over the place, but I skated well. I moved well. You know, at that time, prep school hockey was pretty solid. Oh, yeah, I remember that. I got killed.
You got crushed.
Yeah, no penalty on that one. And there was a lot of good players that played. There's a couple clips in here, a couple of guys that got drafted in the NHL. When I would play it against Cushing, they had Keith Yandel on that team, Chris Bork on that team. We played Avon Old Farms this year. Jonathan Quick was a goalie there. It was a lot of fun playing at that such high level. But you can see I'm pretty aggressive. I like being at the top of my crease. At that age, I probably was a little bit too chaotic. But at the same time, I was smaller. I got the ability to kind of get people to look at me for no other reason. And I like to handle the puck. That's a good little play there. All right, we'll watch one more game. So this is against Gunnery. We beat them. Nice little play, big save, kind of all over the place. My team, a couple turnovers, a couple pizzas, kept me busy. This is a good save. All right. So as you can see, hopefully you guys kind of have somewhat of an idea of me as a goalie. Some of you guys never really got to watch me play. You never got to see me really train. This was when I was 04, 05, so I would have been 17. I was 17 when I went there. So I'm similar to some of your guys' age. And again, everyone has a different path. You can always pick and choose. That's a good save. Pick and choose where you're going to go and how you're going to play or where you're going to play. But you always have to be the best at every level that you go to. So no matter where you play, no matter where you guys pick, always make sure you're having the ability to perform and perform well. Oh, here's a good one. So number three right here, that's Keith Yandle. So he's, I'm not sure if you guys ever heard of that name before, but he's a big-time defenseman in the NHL. We'll watch this last one, and I'll stop pumping my own tires. But you can see I'm a little bit chaotic. Right there was Chris Bork. A couple pizzas. Big, long save. Again. Oh, here we go. Big save. Top of the crease. Look how far I am. And again, everyone plays a little bit different. Then I'm controlled. I'm coming off my post. Here's a crazy save. Right? No matter what, it's how fast you can get back in your net and how hard you can battle. Got hit in the neck with his skate. All right. So just a little rundown memory lane. Thanks for joining me on that one. But just so you guys have an idea of who I am and what the way I used to play. And as I grew, I became a little bit more controlled. I used my positioning a lot better. I was always a fan of moving the puck, handling the puck, being a third defenseman back there. But you guys are all in this time frame where Mason, Mitch, and I are well past our prime, right, for hockey-wise. And we hope
– We are?
We are past our what? Prime. I think we're done climbing the ladder competitively on the playing side. Now we're on to the coaching side. And Mason, you're done climbing the ladder competitively playing. You're starting to climb the ladder as a ref. But remember, your path is going to lead to memories forever, right? Mason, you touched on it. Some of the experiences that you had at juniors and college, you know, led to who you are today. You met your wife. You have some of your best friends that you ever made through is hockey. And I mean this, the higher you get in hockey, the majority of people that you get surrounded with are really, really good people. You're going to have your bad apples just like anywhere. But the higher the level you play, usually the better people that you get to surround yourself with. So if you want to have really good memories, you want to make really good long-lasting friends, you want to be proud of your accomplishments, stay hungry, be hungry, continue to climb the ladder, and making sure that you guys are using this resource that we have here, hopefully, to learn something more. So in closing, Mitch, anything you want to pass along for your last little words of wisdom before we let everybody go?
No, I thought it was a good session. I'm getting ready for my hand-eye in about 12 minutes. So that email that I sent out today to goalies or parents, whoever got it, had both links. So even if you didn't register, hop on. I think we have at least 12 goalies or so. The more the merrier. It's going to be a fun session. So hop on, please.
Perfect. And Mason, any words of wisdom to close down our talk?
Well, first off, thanks for having me, guys. I appreciate, all the hard work you guys are putting in, especially these days. Can't wait to see you back in the ranks. At the end of the day, just like Coach Matt said, it's all about the memories, right? You don't realize, you can't make memories. They kind of just come and go, in the day, in the heat of the moment. Like he said, I met my wife through hockey. My son loves playing. He's only 2 years old, but we got him downstairs in the mini sticks. It's, he's in the rinks with me after goalie sessions sometimes. It's hockey's all of our lives, right? So just enjoy every moment of it. It's a cliche to say have fun, all this kind of stuff. Obviously, you always want to have fun, always be a good guy. Even good guys have their bad days. Use that little piece of adversity towards your favor. Obviously you keep working hard and, there's not one path for everybody. So just because you see Sidney Crosby or Connor McDavid just, buzzing on TSN or ESPN or NBC, doesn't mean that has to be you, right? There's guys that have gone through Division III. There's guys that have gone, through Division I. There's guys that are coaching in the NHL that never played. So as long as you love hockey, it's going to love you back.
Well, Mason, I really do appreciate you coming on. Mitch, always a pleasure. We have one last question, and it's from Jacob. Have any of you guys heard of any rinks opening? So, again, we preface it. Just be careful. There are some rinks that are opening up. Just be mindful. Make sure as you're going through, this isn't the end of the world. You're not going to die if you go to the rink if you do things correctly, right? Make sure you're washing your hands, being conscious of who your surroundings, and make sure that as you're going through, wash your hands and just take care of yourself. Practice good hygiene, and hopefully everything will kind of slowly come back to normal. The rinks that are open, there are a few. As for us, the rinks that we normally work with are not open yet, so we're continuing to keep our fingers crossed. But best of luck to everybody. Thank you again for joining in. The guys that are joining Mitch with the session next, get some water, get yourself ready to rock and roll, and have some fun. Thanks again, everybody.
Thanks, guys. Be safe.
Enjoy.
You guys in 9 minutes. Let's go.
Bye, guys.